Is the screen visible to all of you? Yes or no? Respond. Okay, we will start with the next chapter, legal alien. So what do you understand by the term legal alien? Okay, don't you think these two terms are contradictory in nature? How can an alien be legal? Okay, so alien, what a person has come from, it could be some other country also, it could be some other continent also, or some other planet also. Usually we address the term alien to people of different another planet. So how can it be legal? Okay, legal means what? A person can come and stay in that particular place. There is nothing illegal in it. So these both are contradictory terms, and why it is contradictory we'll get to know as we proceed with the chapter. Okay, note on the author. Ruthyange Crystal Butungi is a writer born in Uganda who did her schooling in Australia and later moved back to Uganda. So first she did her schooling in Australia and then moved back to Uganda. She is from Uganda itself. She wrote the story, The Legal Alien, after she attended a workshop in 2011. Note on the lesson. The story revolves around a young girl who returned to her native Uganda after several years. The protagonist discovers that the school in Uganda is different than the school in Australia. As she struggles to make a place for herself in her own country, she discovers various things and also learns her own language. The themes of identity, language, and education are intertwined. If you people also have done your schooling in different places, let's say primary schooling you have done in your native, then for your high school and college, if you have moved to a different place, and then when you go back to your native place, you can understand this difference. Okay, how the education system is different in different places. Even now, most of you are from outside Karnataka. So you would have done your schooling or place two in your home state. Now you have come to Karnataka, Bangalore especially, and you can identify the difference. And when you go back, let's say after 3 years or 4 years, when you go back to your native place, you feel that you are an alien because you are not able to connect with your own members there as you have moved away from them for a longer duration. Then glossary, Addams Family. The Addams Family, a group of fictional characters created by American cartoonist Charles Addams. Emposi, except, incessant, constant, never-ending. Bambi, young girl. Amin Dada, the third president of Uganda, known for his abuse of power and human rights, and also for ethnic persecution. Abuse of power means misuse of power. Persecution means based on one's, it could be one's religion or religious sect or caste or color or race, punishing somebody or harming somebody. H.E. Museveni, the president of Uganda after Amin. Muammar Gaddafi, Libyan revolutionary and politician. Matoki, a variety of starchy banana. So you should be aware of this glossary also, because since it's a factual based exam, you will be having main exam will consist of both descriptive as well as MCQs. Okay, therefore you should focus on this. So as part of pre-reading activity, we'll discuss the comprehension questions also, so that you will get to know what you should focus while we discuss the text. Why did the receptionist refuse to take the consultation fees? What does the narrator mean when she says, I became aware of my vernacular deprivation in 93? Vernacular deprivation, important term. How does Daisy react when the narrator comes and sits next to her? Why was the teacher surprised when the narrator thanked him? When did the protagonist's family move back to Uganda? How did protagonist spend time during weekends in Uganda? Describe the dilemma that the young narrator faced on her first day of school in Uganda. According to the narrator, of all the barriers, the language barrier made her feel more alienated. Explain with reference to the story. Discuss the protagonist's encounter with the English teacher. Bring out the significance of the cartoon shows discussed in the poem. How does it reflect the cultural differences? Comment on the narrative technique used in the story. Discuss the differentiation system in two different countries? Why do you think the author chose the title Legal Alien? So with these questions in the backdrop and having in the context, imagine yourself that you have moved away from your place. It could be native to a city in India or any other city in the world. You do your education, primary education there, and even higher education. After that, you come back to your original place, native place. Then you feel alienated because in a different place, you would have come across different culture, different language, different mindset. And again, when you come back to your native place, you feel like an alien or you feel alienated because you can't relate yourself to your own people. The story is about a woman or a girl who did a primary schooling in Uganda and then moved to Australia. And again, after her education, she relocated to Uganda. When she relocated, she finds it difficult to such an extent, she does not know the Ugandan language itself. Because since she relocated to Australia along with her father, she knows only English and she does not know her own mother tongue. Okay, that is why she says language deprivation, how she is deprived of her language. So lesson 4, Legal Alien, Ruthyange Crystal Butangi. I can't believe the receptionist is not going to take my consultation fee just because I am from a tribe. See, as you know, Uganda, it's an African country. Africa is full of tribes. And that is what the author also explains. That is, here, since the receptionist got to know, actually, the gist of the story is the author wants to get a medical certificate. Therefore, she goes to this particular medical clinic. Okay, and the receptionist happens to be from her own tribe. I thought corruption was only for the politicians and big businessmen. But here, in a small town clinic, I'm going to be the beneficiary of a corrupt doctor's receptionist. Okay. Who is corrupt here? Beneficiary of corrupt doctor's receptionist. Is the receptionist corrupt or the doctor corrupt? It should have been doctor's corrupt receptionist. Is this a good idea or a bad thing? Well, I don't care right now. I have spent the day running around offices, getting papers stamped. Now I have to get a doctor to give me a checkup, approve this medical form and stamp it. So say she's going somewhere else, especially for her higher education. For that, she needs a medical certificate. Therefore, she is running from pillar to post to get all the documents properly. And she also needs to get a medical certificate. To get a medical certificate, she has visited this particular medical clinic. And in that clinic, the receptionist happens to be from the same tribe of hers. I was about to walk out of this clinic because the consultation fee alone without the medical checkup fee was way too high. See here, there you have consultation fee and you have the medical checkup fee. Means what does it mean? Consultation fee itself is more. For example, let's say you visit a doctor. Okay. In order to consult, they will charge 400 rupees. Then medical checkup fee means what? Fee means what? Let's say you want to get injected or you want to be hospitalized or nebulized. Those things cost extra. So what discourages the author to avoid this medical store, medical clinic? It's a doctor clinic. It's not a medical store. Is the consultation fee itself was more. But then the receptionist glimpsed my name on the form and said, hey, you mean you are from my village? Why didn't you tell me your surname? I would have done you a favor. Then she started chatting away in our language. Our language means what? The language that to which the receptionist and she belongs to. But unfortunately, the author can't speak, or the narrator or the protagonist in the story can't speak her own mother tongue. If you had told me where you are from, I wouldn't have told you to pay that high consultation fee. In fact, I have got enough food today. So don't bother paying for consultation. Just wait for the patient who is in now to come out and you can go in for your checkup. Thank goodness she sneaked those last sentences in English. Because forget about the protagonist or this lady narrator talking about in her own language. She can't even understand when other people speak. Okay. She started rattling on in our language, rattling, talking continuously. I dared not inform her that I didn't understand a single word she was saying. Today was not going to be the day I revealed my excuse for not knowing my mother tongue. What is the mistake? She does not know how to speak in her own mother tongue. Forget about speaking. She can't even understand. See, in listening skills and all, we say, communication skills, we say LSRW, listening, speaking, reading and writing. Let's say I say, I know how to speak in English. I can do all the LSRW in English, and even the same holds good with Kannada. But when it comes to other languages, for example, Hindi. Hindi, I can understand a bit, talk a bit, but I am not that fluent when compared to Hindi and when compared to English and Kannada. Okay? Her situation is even worse. She can't even understand. I will not reveal to her that I became aware of my vernacular deprivation in 93. The dates you should know in our year. Vernacular deprivation. Vernacular means what? Language. When I was a child, daddy had taken me to the classroom and left me there. I stopped sobbing when the teacher led me in. So again, in this entire story, she keeps on talking about her past events. It's a mix of both the present and the past. See, now what she is saying is she is actually a first person narrator. The author is the first person narrator here. She is talking about her experiences and about her vernacular deprivation. She says she is now talking about her childhood, how she became aware of her vernacular deprivation in 93. Daddy had taken me to the classroom and left me there. I stopped sobbing when the teacher led me in. The room was so big. There was over 100 children in there, at least 7 pupils on each of the 15 or so benches. The walls were dirty, and you would see where the blue paint had been chipped at by enthusiast kids. There were no cupboards, no teacher's desk, no carpet, no sleeping corner, no tiles. So this is the description of the Ugandan school that she is informing us. The room held only children, benches, a cemented floor, and a huge old blackboard positioned at the front. Everything was so dated. Dated means outdated. It was as if the decor had been inspired by the Addams Family episode. At the back of the classroom, bags were sprawled all over the floor since there was not enough hooks on the wall to carry them all. I looked up at the man who I assumed was the class teacher, as I had heard my daddy address him as Mr. Muhan Gazima, and asked, "Where is the fridge?" So you should understand, when she's talking about this story at that time, she had already come back from Australia. Means she did her schooling in Australia, and again after a few years she came back to Uganda. When she came back to Uganda, on the very first day of the school, she asked her class teacher, that is Mr. Muhan Gazima, about asking, "Where is the fridge?" There were loud gasps and class started laughing. I began to cry again. Mr. Muhan Gazima bent down and quietly said, "This is a classroom. We don't keep fridges in classroom. We don't have a fridge in the school except the one in the canteen. Suppose there's a new one in the kitchen." So this narrator is of the perspective, or the context is from that of the Australian expectation. But here in Uganda, the teacher says, we don't have fridges in our classroom, and even in the entire school you don't have one single fridge except one in this one, where except one in the canteen. "But where will I keep my break time snacks? Just leave them in your bag and then put it at the back of the classroom." Means they used to, the day she went to the classroom, she found a dirty place. Okay, the classroom stood, there were no benches, or even if there are benches, many students used to sit on that, and they had thrown all their bags at the backside of the class. That is what the teacher also says when she questions where to keep her lunchtime snacks. "He led me to the back and pulled one bag off a strong hook, hastily threw it into the ground and put mine in its place. I couldn't understand my new surroundings. Back in Australia, my grade 2 class with just 32 pupils was the biggest in the whole school." See, in the Australian class, students were just 32, and that itself was the biggest classroom strength. And here in the one class itself, there are 100 students. That's why she feels that she can't understand. "Each class had a fridge to keep snacks until break time and a microwave to warm them in if necessary." So in the Australian classroom, consisted of a refrigerator and a microwave oven. "My Australian class had a carpet for story time and tables for writing at and red and blue building blocks for doing algebra. We also had a painting corner. So if you are asked your main exam will be consisting of both MCQs and descriptive type. So if they ask you to describe the Australian classroom, you have to mention all this. Okay, we also had a painting corner, an imaginary corner, and a sleeping corner for taking afternoon naps. Look at the facilities provided. And we could wear anything we wanted. Not like this school where I had to wear white socks pulled up to my knees and green and white check dress that looked exactly like the ones mummy used to wear when she was pregnant with my younger brother. So she says her uniform is similar to the dress that her mother wore during the narrator's brother's pregnancy at that time. Except mine had a belt, such a strange uniform. Mr. Mohan Gazima took me to the bench at the back of the classroom. There were five pupils seated at it. Daisy is a good girl, he said as he beckoned me into a seat next to a thin-lipped girl. She will make friends with you. He walked away chuckling as though it was hard for him to suppress his laughter. So Daisy is one of the notorious girls, and this class teacher, since there was no space anywhere else, he asked this narrator to go and sit next to Daisy, and in a funny manner he says she is the most friendly girl, and he himself chuckles coming out of the way because he knows to what extent she is naughty. As soon as I sat and said hello, Daisy pulled away from me and in doing so almost pushed the others off the bench. She looked down at her book and continued doing the math exercise that Mr. Mohan Gazima had left on the board. I'd never have to add 15 to 12 without using building blocks. So she says the way she was taught mathematics or algebra during her Australian school was different from this, because without using the building blocks, she does not know how to solve any math problem. So I could not understand a thing. I didn't want to be laughed at again, so I didn't ask for them. Every time I tried to ask Daisy to explain, she inched further and further away from me. It was as if she was blocking me. There was some barrier I could not penetrate. So though she wanted to become a friend with Daisy was hesitant. Barriers, my attention was brought back to the receptionist's incessant rambling. So now she again comes back to the present. Somewhere in between, I figured out she had offered me a seat in the waiting area right in front of her desk. It's 2011 and I still feel like there are barriers I cannot penetrate, like this one. She feels that in her life, there are plenty of barriers which she can't penetrate. What on earth is she saying to me? It's been 18 years and I still feel like the girl my classmates were inching away from. I can't break into certain social circles because of this barrier. What is that barrier? The barrier is the language barrier. Either I'm trying to break into people's life, but they shrink from me because they don't understand me, or I'm avoiding people because I'm too ashamed to reveal that I don't understand them. So why is that she feels that there is a barrier? Well, it's because people avoid her. And secondly, she herself is hesitant to convey that she does not know much about her own community or her own language. I wish I could hide from receptionist right now. What if she figures out that I can't speak her language? Will she still think of me as a village mate, or will she feel take advantage of and withdraw her no consultation fee offer? So this narrator is in a dilemma whether to reveal the truth to her village mate. I've encountered so many barriers. See, as a woman, she has encountered so many barriers, she says. Which are those? Age barrier, education barrier, gender barrier. But none has made me feel as alienated as the language barrier. She feels language barrier, overcoming the language barrier is the difficult part for her. Anyone can understand a woman fighting for her rights, but few comprehend how one can fail to learn their own language. Thank goodness more patients have walked in. Now the receptionist. Now the receptionist is preoccupied with explaining to them the high consultation fee prices. One patient has a Kenyan accent. Lucky her. Everyone can understand why she can't speak any Ugandan languages. Perhaps next time I walk into a place, I should speak with a foreign accent so that people can immediately address me in English. Her, that thought reminds me again of the first day in school. She feels that the moment she enters any place, that she should talk in a foreign accent so that people can communicate to her in English. After the episode with Daisy, it was time for school social sciences. The teacher was skinny and tall. She walked to the front of the door and crooned, "Good morning, P3K. Good morning, Miss Nakan Wagi." Everyone stood up to greet her. "Good, sit down. Where is the new girl?" Everyone turned and looked at me. "Hey, they have not yet cut your hair. Did the headmaster give you a permission to take your long hair?" I didn't notice that none of the girls had hair on their heads because I had time to think about it. The teacher had sent a boy from the front of the class to the back and told me to take his place. At the front, I felt as if people's stares were piercing my back. So the teacher insists this narrator to come and sit in the front row. When she was sitting in the front row, she felt that everybody is looking at her. Halfway through the lesson, I began to feel stupid because I could not answer any questions. She was asking about Mantu and Sarah, the first humans on Earth, and they moved on to some tale mentioning Girpur and Labang. Then she asked the shape of the world. Finally, I shot my hand up. I definitely knew the answer, this one. "Yes, new girl, stand up and give us the answer. It's a circle," I shouted, beaming. The class burst and laughing. Repeat, the teacher made me to repeat my answer until my new classmate started mimicking my accent. I sat down depressed. Everyone was laughing at me. So people started making fun of her accent. Because she had an Australian accent, influences of Australian English in her Australian English, because she didn't know Uganda, it's Ugandan languages itself. I was so relieved when it was time for break. I wished I could have hidden somewhere in the school and not written for another class. Before walking off to eat, I went to thank the teachers of their classes. They were sitting at the table on the classroom veranda. My thanking them sparked off some kind of debate. So what happened? She went to thank the teachers for engaging the class. Okay. And that itself became a topic of debate among teachers because they haven't found any student coming to the staff room and thanking them for teaching. "Hey Bambi, the girl is from outside countries, but she is well-mannered," said one of the teachers. "You mean from Bulaya have bad manners? People from Bulaya have bad manners?" Mr. Mohan Gazima always seemed kind and supportive when he spoke. "Nanti, they are always proud and spoiled when they come back. But this one, Bambi, even thanks us for teaching." So this is the discussion that is happening among teachers in the staff room. They are talking about the incidents where the narrator thanks the teachers for teaching. Then they have a discussion. I have heard people have a lot of attitude or ego problems, especially people from abroad. Then he says, then another teacher says nothing like that with this particular girl. "Vama, go and have your breakfast before the bell rings." When I turned around to look for a place to sit, I wished I could have stayed with Mohan Gazima instead. Better, because all the children were avoiding me. The school was so big. The road from the main gate led up to a roundabout. On the left side of the road was the lower primary section, made a primary right hand and the road. This included the school kitchen, administrative offices, main hall and staff room. Each school had five streams, NPSK and U, derived from Nakasero Primary School, Kampala, Uganda. That is the name of the school. When Daddy and I had reported to the headmaster's office that morning, the headmaster asked, I had said, because I was given in greenhouse in my school in Australia, so I located me to P3K because all the K classes were in the green building of Eland House. Whoever designed the school was very organized because each block of classes have different classroom for the five streams. And the classes were huge, accommodating only over 100 pupils per stream. The P3 and P4 blocks were separated by a big grassy fence compound. I sat on a step on the veranda of my on the P3 block near the teacher's table. I began to eat the break and cake mummy had packed for me. Then Daisy came up to me with another boy and asked, "Vama, did you used to talk to Eddie Murphy? So she talks about all the events that took place during her and after or the impact of her change in schooling? Who is Eddie Murphy? I responded. The one who acted in Coming to America. I don't know. Eddie Murphy, I came from Australia, not America. Because he has made his plan to move to Australia in order to avoid any kind of repercussions. This boy said that your father is a black American. He saw your dad bringing you. He even heard him talking to, talking from America. My father is Ugandan, but we used to live in Australia. You see, I told you, she said to the boy, and they walked off arguing. Then break time was done. Break time means the time that they are given for lunch. The English teacher was awful. She started with my bench, which was at the front. I couldn't open my book with the homework she wanted, because she wanted my first child pen. I didn't have any homework completed. I didn't want her to get to me, because I hated the way she was screaming insults about everyone's work. So she was very much, she had developed a lot of animosity towards her English teacher, because she was, she hated the students, or she was very much strict. But I didn't have enough time to nurture my fear, because I was the fourth person in the row. Where is the homework? She asked. I am, she was about to answer, but immediately she slaps. Don't tell me your nonsense. Where is homework? Before I could answer, her hand slapped me hard across my face. Didn't you hear me telling people to open their homework on the bench? So she's very dogmatic, and she even slapped her English teacher slapped her. The multiple shouts from the class telling her that it was, I was a new pupil, silenced her, and she walked on just like that, screaming at time person in broken English. I had never been slapped before except by my mummy. I tried to be a Superman and flew off top of the cupboard and sprained my knee and pretend to be dead. So this was her intention, that she intend to become a Superman and so that she can slap everybody and move around. But why would a teacher beat a student? In Australia, a teacher hit a child once in many mystery. In any cases, in my nursery school, was arrested. No one is allowed to beat the children there except their parents and guardians. And even then, there are restrictions on how much a parent could beat their own children. See, to what extent the law and order is organized in a country like Australia. Then beating. So initially, she here mentions, what does she mention about? Which activity does she mention about? It's highlighted, I guess. It's barriers. First, she talks about barriers. You should make a note. Next, she talks about beatings. What happens in beatings? Where did we miss that page? Beating. It is strange how I gotten so used to it over the years. I am not even perturbed by the sound of policemen beating idlers on Bombo Road just outside the building. Idlers means those who keep on roaming around without any work. The clinic is on the fourth floor, where the tear gas does not seem to have had a much effect. The receptionist finished with the other patients and turned back to me. By a gesture, I could tell she was saying something about the ongoing riots. Ever since Muammar Gaddafi died, the opposition thinks it's an outright law to overthrow our president too. It can overthrow a president too. So every Monday they hold walk to work demonstrations, walk to work. As a protest against the ruling party, they are conducting demonstrations named walk to work. All opposition party members and parliamentarians walk to their office. Idlers and workers in town stand by the police, stand by the roadsides to cheer them on or join them. So every Monday morning, the police and army roam about in mambas, spraying tear gas and pink water at the crowds. Then the shops close for a few hours to prevent theft until the protesters are arrested and released on bail. then the business put on the demonstration because the walk to work campaign disrupts their profit making. Then the university students hold a strike because the lecturers used to campaign to extend their weekends. This cycle has continued for months, such that medical workers, teachers, and lawyers have also taken turns going on strike. I would like to use the routine to stay safe at home, but this week is my deadline for sending the papers. So here she describes about why she is reminded about the beating, how her own teacher beat her, and after that it has been, she has been used to it. Okay. And she says there is a political unrest in the country, and every day there are one or the other demonstrations. And she is also a victim of the demonstration, and therefore at any cost. But this week is my deadline for sending the papers. Sending the papers, she intends to pursue her master's in Australia. Therefore, she needs to submit certain documents. In order to submit certain documents, it has to get sealed by the government there, and also by the medical practitioner. Therefore, she visits the medical practitioner. This morning, I took a taxi before the sun rose and before the protesters started walking to work. I wisely spent the morning going to offices further from the town center where there wasn't commotion. In the afternoon, I had to brave the remaining disturbances to visit the offices in town. I hid in the crowded toilets of commercial buildings and turned on a tap to wash tear gas out of my eyes, because the impact of tear gas was so much that it would have hampered her medical examination. Therefore, she washes her face cleanly. Everyone was in their offices because they couldn't go out into smoky streets. So I got everything else signed and stamped except my medical forms. There was no way I was going to get through to the taxi park to go to my family's clinic. Well, at least now, until the evening, when everyone would stop rioting and go home. So I stopped at the first signposted town clinic and entered into the safest looking building. And here I am now staring at the receptionist's blabbering mouth. Our pseudo conference was interrupted by a small crowd rushing a bleeding child into the reception. So, and again, she is talking about the present she is having. She is conversing with the receptionist, false kind of conversation. Okay. But that was disturbed by a couple who came along with the child, and the child was bleeding. Either way, the blood managed to mingle with mucus from the nose, and so was smeared all over the left side of the child's face. The mother was wailing. She looked more terrified than the injured little girl, who was sobbing quietly. The girl must have been about 8 years old, and they whisked her into the emergency room. I thought the receptionist would finally be silenced by the horrific scene. I was wrong. It gave her a lot more to blabber about. I think she started talking about the things that women make women and girls cry. I hate seeing crying girls. They remind me of that unforgettable first day. Who is unforgettable first day? The first day of the author, narrator in her Ugandan school, second time when she joined. Okay. This is what she feels. She hates to see women and girls cry, because whenever she finds a woman or a girl crying, she recollects her childhood. Okay.